So friends, the next point we are going to see here, that is sources of microorganisms in food material. So there are different sources are there from which that microorganisms, they get enter into the food material. And when microorganisms enter into food material and when that conditions are favorable or factors are favorable, that may be the intrinsic factors or that may be the intrinsic factors, at that time these microorganisms, they grow and multiply in that food material and they can cause the spoilage of food material. So which are the different sources from which that microorganisms enter inside the food material? And there are 8 different types of sources are here from which that microorganisms enters in the food. That includes plants, animals, then air, soil, sewage, then water, human, and equipments or utensils we can see here. So all these are the different types of sources from which that microorganisms can enter into the food material. So one by one we are going to see here. The first one is the plants. So the plants, and inside the tissues of these plants or animal, that is actually sterile. Okay. So the tissues as well as tissues of that plant or animal, generally it is sterile. That means it is free of microorganism. And at the same time, some plants, they have the ability to produce some natural antimicrobial substances that can limit the presence of microbes or microorganisms. Sometimes what happens is that particular that microorganisms, they enter inside the food material, but itself that food material has the ability, or they can produce some antimicrobial substances or metabolites. And because of production of these antimicrobial substances or metabolites, that microorganisms which are enter in the food material, that can be killed, or the growth of that microorganisms can be inhibited. Then fruits and vegetables, they harbor large number of microorganisms on their surface. Because what are that plants? Because fruits and vegetables, these are nothing but the plants here. And these fruits and vegetables on their surface consist of large number of microorganisms. The type as well as number varies or different with soil condition, type of fertilizers, and water used. For example, if there is a that particular soil is of rich in nutrients, so generally the plants coming from that particular soil or coming from that particular field, it has the large number of microbial population on that plants or that vegetables or fruits here. At the same time, if there is a use of chemical fertilizers at maximum proportion, then the microorganism present in soil, these are very less. But actually use of these chemical fertilizers for the cultivation of crop, it will allow the decreases the soil fertility. And that's why use of chemical fertilizers, generally it is not recommended, though that kills the microorganisms. And at the same time, the water which is used for the irrigation of that plants or vegetables or fruits in that particular soil, that also decides the how many or what type of microorganisms should be present in that soil or in that plants or fruits and vegetables. And pathogens can be present if that soil is contaminated with untreated sewage. So if there is a release of untreated sewage in the river, and if that same river water is utilized for the irrigation purposes, then maximum pathogens can be added in that soil, and that same pathogens will come in the plants, that may be the crops, that may be the fruits, or that may be the vegetables. And that disease plants, for example, if that crop plants or that fruits and vegetable plants, if they get infected with the disease microorganisms, then damage the plants during harvesting or unfavorable storage condition, so they can increase the number of microorganisms present in the that raw vegetables or fruits or the crops or grains also here. So in this way, that plants, they can add the different types of microorganisms itself in that food material here. Then another one is here. Second one is the animals. So animals, they can also act as a source of microorganisms for the plants here. Okay, or in case of food material. And that animals as well as birds, they can carry the different types of microorganisms in their digestive system. In digestive system, in teat canal, that is in udder, or in on skin, then on hooves of that animals, then hairs as well as scales. So these are the different parts of the animals or birds which consist of large number of microorganisms. And that sometimes that disease condition, which is called as the mastitis. Mastitis, it is the inflammation of udders in milking animals, specifically in cow, that can change the ecology of the microflora. That means if that particular animal is infected with this bacteria, that is mastitis causing bacteria or microorganisms, so that can be present in the milk also. That is nothing but the food. So in this way also, that microorganisms, they can enter into the food material, and poor sanitation in the husbandry or in particular cattle farm, that can lead to the fecal contamination of the food products here. If there is no proper sanitation, if there is no maintenance of the cleanliness, so that can add the that poor husbandry or poor sanitation conditions or situation, that can add microorganisms into the food material. So that milk can be contaminated with the fecal material on the udder surface. Okay, because from the udder, from the teats, that milking is done. Okay, but if that udder is surface of that udder is covered with the fecal material of cows or animals, then that pathogens or that microorganisms can be added in the milk, or that milk get contaminated. Then meat products can be contaminated with the intestinal contents of the animals. If that animal is suffering from particular disease here or digestive disorders, then the digestive system of that animals can consist of the large number of pathogens here, okay, or microorganisms. And therefore, the meat products which are taken from these or produced from such infected animals, so that can consist of the microorganisms, or that meat and meat products get contaminated. Then eggs can be contaminated from the eggshell. Then if you want to prevent the entry of these microorganisms from the animal sources in that food material, then some precautions must be taken so that we can avoid the contamination of food material, or we can prevent the contamination of food material here. So which are that conditions here? The first one is the good condition of animals and birds husbandry. That should be properly sanitation, or proper husbandry or cleanliness should be there. Then properly slaughtering of that animals in case of slaughterhouse or in meat industry. Then washing with clean water, washing of that animals with clean water, that will reduce the chances of contamination. Then removal of digestive system without contaminating other tissues. Okay, so if you want to, if you are able to remove the digestive system of that animals, that means you are removing the microorganisms present in the digestive system. Then proper sanitation during the entire processing process. So whatever that processing will be there, and if there is a proper sanitation, cleanliness will be there, then that will reduces the chances of contamination, or that will reduces the contamination of by microorganisms. Then proper cleaning of udder before milking. So in case of milking animals, so when that milking process, actual milking process is here, at that time, if you wash properly the udder or the teats of that animals, milking animals, then there is a decrease in the contamination by microorganisms, or there is a decrease in the chances of contamination. Then collecting of eggs soon after laying. So immediately after the laying of eggs by that egg-laying animals or hens, that eggs should be collected immediately and washed and stored using the proper procedure. Then fish and marine products should be harvested from the unpolluted water. Because if you are harvesting that fish and other fishes here or marine animals, so that contaminated or polluted water will add more microorganisms in the food material. And if we consume such contaminated food material, we get suffered from the infection or from the food poisoning. So this is about the animals. That is the second source of microorganisms which get added into the food material. The next source of contamination is here, which adds the microorganisms, that includes the air. So the microorganisms which are present in the dust, they don't grow actually, because dust, it is nothing but the arid condition, or it does not have any water activity, or there is absence of water, and that's why microorganisms, though they are present, but they cannot be added here, or they cannot multiply. Then another one is here, the level of the level is controlled by the degree of humidity, temperature, as well as air velocity. So how much microorganisms will be present in that air, that depends on the humidity, temperature, and the velocity of the or speed of the air. So that moist air, it consists of moist air, it consists of dust particles as well as microbes, and that pathogens can be transmitted through the air from their spores, because air, it consists of large number of spores or endospores, which are generally resistant to the different types of antimicrobial conditions here. Okay, and microbial contamination from the air, that can be decreased, or we can control. How? Just by removing the potential sources, then controlling dust particles in the air, that is by using the filtered air, then using positive air pressure, reducing the humidity level in the air, and installing the ultraviolet light. Because installation of ultraviolet light, that will kill the microorganisms present in the air. So this is the another source of microorganisms microorganisms which can be added into the food material. The next one is the soil. So all of you know that, friends, soil is the rich source of microorganisms, because it consists of different types of microorganisms, and that soil is used to grow the agricultural product as well as to raise the animals. That is the main, because whatever that crops or any agricultural products we are producing here, that we are producing on the soil. And microbes that can be entered into the food material from the soil, they can multiply there in the food material, and that's why the number of that microorganisms can be increased to a very high population that will cause the food spoilage. Then soil which get contaminated with the that fecal matter, if that soil is contaminated with fecal material, that can be a source of intestinal pathogenic bacteria as well as viruses in the food material. Because if that soil is contaminated with fecal matter, so that will add the large number of microorganisms in the food material, that is in the soil first. And if you are cultivating, or if you are growing that crops or fruits and vegetables in the same soil which is contaminated with the fecal matter, so that soil adds the large number of intestinal pathogens in the food material, and that may be the bacterial pathogens, or that may be the viral pathogens. So in this way, that soil, it can add the microorganisms in the food material. Next one is here, that is sewage. So if used as a fertilizer in crops, then microorganisms present in the sewage water, that can contaminate the food material, and that food material specifically get contaminated with the enteropathogenic bacteria and viruses. Enteropathogenic, that is means intestinal pathogens, because again, that sewage, it is nothing but the used water supply from the houses or homes. So that water supply coming from the used water coming from the homes or houses, that definitely consists of the pathogenic microorganisms. And if this sewage water is used for the irrigation purposes or added to the soil, so that will contaminate the soil here. And especially that originally grown food and many imported fruits and vegetables, they get contaminated with such sewage water. So how we can prevent the addition of microorganisms from this sewage? That is by avoiding using sewage as a fertilizer or for the irrigation purposes. Then you have to wash that fruits and vegetables properly, and treat the sewage to kill the pathogens. Because sewage may be consist of the large number of pathogens here, and that's why that sewage should be treated by proper sewage treatment plant or in sewage treatment plant, so that whatever the toxic substances, whatever the pathogens are present in sewage, that get removed, and then we can use that sewage as a or for the irrigation purposes. The next one is source of contamination is here, that is water. So all of you know that water is very important part in the any that may be the human body, that may be the animal body, or that may be the crops here. and used to process, produce and store food material. So this water, it is useful for the processing of fruits and vegetables, production of fruits and vegetables, that is during the cultivation, and as well as it is also used to store the food material. And other purposes where that water is used, that includes irrigation, drinking, washing, then canning process, as well as freezing process. And this water, it is also used as an ingredient or main component in many processed food. And that's why the quality of water, it is affecting or influencing the microbial quality of food material or the microorganisms present in the food material. And that's why it is very essential to use treated water for the irrigation purposes, for washing purposes, for canning purposes, or for freezing purposes, or for production also. So chlorine treated potable water, so that should be used in the all these processes here. That may be processing, that may be washing, that may be sanitation. Because if you are using improperly treated water for these different purposes, so that can add the, or that can consist of the pathogen, and that pathogen can be added in the fruits, vegetables, or crops here, which results into the spoilage of that food material here. So in this way, we can add the that water can add the microorganisms in the food material, and that can act as an important source of the contamination of foods here. The next point is here, our source of microorganisms in food material, that is nothing but the human being. So food, it can come in contact with the different pupils during the handling of that food material, and that may be the pupils, they are involved in the processing of the food material. So that food handlers in restaurant, catering services, then food suppliers, food producers. So all these activities are done by the human. And that's why human can act as a source of spoilage causing microorganisms, non-pathogenic microorganisms, as well as pathogenic microorganisms. And therefore, if that food is handled by such persons, so that food get contaminated with the pathogenic microorganisms. And if that contaminated food are consumed by the persons or human, so that can lead to the diseases here. And there are different factors are there which affect the microorganisms present in the food material. That includes improperly clean hands. That means if there is no proper sanitation is here by the food handlers, food transporters, or like that, so they will add microorganisms in the food. Then lack of personal hygiene and aesthetic sense. Then dirty cloths and hairs, presence of minor cuts, so that can add the pathogens in the food material. Then infections on hands and face. Then mild generalized diseases, that may be the flu or throat infection. So all these factors, they can add microorganisms in the food material. And that's why human can act as an important source of pathogenic as well as non-pathogenic microorganisms. So what can we do here? So we can prevent the entry of these pathogenic, non-pathogenic microorganisms into food from the human being. So that is by using the proper training of personal in persons in personal hygiene. Then regular health checkup and maintain efficient sanitary in the food industry. So in this way, the entry of that microorganisms in the food material, that can be prevented. And the last source of microorganisms in food material is here, that is nothing but the equipments or the instruments or the utensils which are used for the processing, transportation, as well as storage of food material. So large number of equipment, these are used in harvesting, in processing, in transportation, as well as in storage of the food material. And different types of microorganisms, that may be from air, that may be from raw foods, that may be from water, or can be from personal or persons, they can get into the instruments, they can enter into the equipment, or they can enter into the different materials here. And so therefore, they can contaminate the food material or foods. So when processing equipments are used continuously for a longer period of time, then that microorganism, they are present initially, they can multiply, and they act as a, that means that machineries or that equipments, that can be act as a source of contamination. So these are the different types of sources of microorganisms in food that we have seen here. about plants, about animals, then air, soil, sewage, water, human, and then equipments. Okay, so these are the different sources here. So the next point we are going to see here, that is about the significance of microorganisms present in the food material. Okay, so one by one I will explain here. So all of these concepts you know, and these microorganisms present in the food, they play the very important role in the spoilage as well as in the fermentation. Okay, and these different types of microorganisms can be found in food material, that includes bacteria, that includes fungi, that is yeast and molds, that may be viruses, then different types of protozoans, algae, helminths, then that protozoans and helminths, these are considered as an accidental food material. See, these are the different types of microorganisms here, which are present in the food, that is protozoans, then these helminths, then bacteria, viruses, yeast, mold. So in this way, so these different types of microorganisms will be present. These are the factors affecting microbial growth in food. Yesterday we have seen that composition or like that, all these we have things here. See, this is about the pH of the food material. So this is water, this is potato here, banana, then tomatoes, then citric acid here, lemon. So these are the, and this is acid completely. Okay, and here the pH increases. So that is, so we have seen all this here, processing of some fermented foods. See, this is about the significance of microorganisms in food material, because we know that microorganisms, they are very useful to us as well as they are harmful to us. Why they are useful? Because these microorganisms are used for the production of fermented foods here. Okay, so that's why these are useful. And at the same time, that microorganisms, they can cause the spoilage of food material as well as they can cause the foodborne diseases here. So that's why these are harmful or these are not useful. So here we are going to show what is the significance of these microorganisms in food. And as we know, these microorganisms are used to produce the fermented food material. Okay, so that we are going to see here. So this is the cheese making process, actually simple. That is the milk, then rennet, it is the starter culture we can see here, or it is the enzyme preparation. Then bacterial culture is also added, cheese cloth, then mold is there. And finally, these are the microorganisms here. So these mold, these are used for the production of cheese here, or in the cheese making process. And in this way, these microorganisms, that's why they are useful to us, or they are significant to us here, because these are used for the making of cheese product here. So this is the cheese making process here, how that cheese can be made here. So that milk, it is treated with the lactic acid, then bacteria, as well as the enzyme, which is called as the renin enzyme, which is mainly involved in the partial hydrolysis or breakdown of the protein. And then after the breakdown of that protein, that renin enzyme, it causes the coagulation of the milk here, that results into the formation of curds. And the liquid portion of the milk at this, because curd is formed and the liquid portion is remaining here, that is called as the whey. Okay, so in this way, that is resulted into the formation of whey here. And the whey is separated from the curds, and then curds is aged, or that is ripened. Then the different types of microorganisms in the early stages as well as in late stages of this process, that produces the cheeses with different characteristics or that flavors here. So this is the cheese making process here, simple, how that microorganism is significant to us. And that we are taking one example, that is they are used in the production of cheese. So this is the milk, then pasteurization of that milk, it kills the and unwanted microorganisms present in that milk. Then addition of the starter bacterial culture for that is nothing but the bacteria here. Then the starter cultures or that bacteria, they will cause the coagulation of milk present in the protein, and that result into the formation of curd. Okay, so that result into the formation of curd. Now after formation of curd, there is a disposal of the liquid portion here, that is called as the whey, and that is nothing but the waste product. Okay, and next one is here. This is the production of processed unprocessed cheese here. Then cutting off curds. When there is a complete removal of that whey or that liquid portion, so it will become solid. Then cutting off curds and that production of that processed cheese through the pressing of that curd here by removal of water also and addition of secondary microbial cultures and the aging process, or that is kept as it is after the addition of cultures here. Okay. So in this way, now another one is here. Significant role we can see here, that is nothing but the also the another milk product here, and that is called as yogurt production. So the milk is fermented by the mixture of Streptococcus salivarius species, then Thermophilus and Lactobacillus bulgaricus, and these organisms, they are co-cultured with another types of lactic acid bacteria for the taste or for the health effects, because that lactic acid bacteria, they can be act as a probiotics. And that includes Lactobacillus acidophilus, Lactobacillus casei, and Bifidobacterium. So they can be used for the yogurt production, and at the same time, they are act as a probiotics here. So the acid produced from the fermentation, it causes the protein present in milk, that is casein, to coagulate into the semi-solid curd. And so if you want, you can add the strawberries or peaches for the flavor here. See, this is the process here, yogurt production, raw milk, then homogenization or pasteurization. So that raw milk, it is pasteurized and crushed for fat by pressure. Then milk is cooled to about 40 degrees. Then starter cultures are added here. That is nothing but the lactic acid bacteria are added. Then properly mixed with a starter culture. Then the fermentation will take place here. That is at 40 degrees Celsius temperature, when that lactic acid bacteria are added, because these lactic acid bacteria, they can causes the fermentation, then cooling process, and finally it results into the formation of the yogurt. And in this way, you can add strawberry also here for the flavor. So that is the next beneficial role we can see here, or how that microorganisms are significant here. That is nothing but they can be used for the production of bread. And that involves the growth of Saccharomyces cerevisiae, which is also called as the baker's yeast. Okay, so that so this baker's yeast that produces the carbon dioxide and that leavens the bread. So other microbes that can use to make the special breads, for example, sourdough bread, and that can be spoiled by the bacillus species that produces the ropiness in the milk or in that bread here. So this is about the bread. Another significant role of microorganism. So just